Yes, to talk more about the poverty issue is Ibon Foundation Executive Director Sunny Africa. Good morning, Sunny. Welcome back to the program.
Morning, Sir Mike. Thanks for the invitation. Hi.
All right, so Sunny, let's begin with a basic definition of poverty. The Philippine Statistics Authority sets a poverty threshold at 12,000 pesos and 12,030 pesos per month. Is this an accurate gauge, and how does the PSA go about computing this amount?
We don't think it's a very good gauge for poverty. We think it's a very low ambition target for poverty reduction, because that only comes about to 79 pesos per person per day on average for all their food and non-food needs. So we think it is a bit too low. The PSA has a very actually simple way to compute it. They compute about 55 pesos in terms of food needs, supposedly for the minimum calorie intake, energy intake. And then they have a multiplier of maybe 1.3 to get the 79%. So our contention there is the 55 pesos per person per day for food is too low. And the 1.3 multiplier is a bit mechanical. It should be updated with how expensive non-food items are becoming. For instance, like, you know, fuel right now, and all the other non-food needs.
And how different is the poverty threshold from the subsistence incidence, which the PSA set at around 8,379 pesos per month?
Of course, the subsistence incidence is much lower at 55 pesos. So there are more families reaching that 55 pesos. But actually, that's exactly our point of contention. It's very low. I think if the idea for the government is to be ambitious to reduce poverty, you don't set a low 79 pesos poverty line or a 55 peso poverty line, because that's actually quite easy to achieve. And in all honesty, the improvement between 2015 and 2018 wasn't because the economy was creating enough jobs, enough decent work. The biggest reason for the big reduction in poverty in 2015 to 2018, the previous poverty period, was because there was an almost 7,000 peso increase in the four-piece budget. But again, we're not seeing that same increase between 2018 and 2021, aggravated by, you know, misguided overlong lockdowns among the harshest in the world, especially in Southeast Asia. That's why poverty increased in 2021, especially because there was no more social amelioration program subsidies in 2021.
And let's talk about the figures. Both the poverty incidence and the subsistence incidence actually increased based on the latest PSA report. You have poverty incident rate hitting 18.1%. So that's about 20 million in 2021. That's up from 16.7% or 17.67 million in 2018. While the subsistence incidence rate went up from 5.2% in 2018 to 5.9% in 2021. You said this was aggravated by the pandemic, but are there any other factors? Which factors are solely to blame or primarily to blame for this?
Actually, to be more precise, it's not actually because of the pandemic. It was because of the lockdowns, which are two, unfortunately, two distinct things. The pandemic hit every country in the world, but because the lockdowns of the Philippines ever since the start, they're very misguided. They were too long. They were too harsh. The lack of public health measures and the over-reliance on lockdowns to contain the pandemic, that caused the economy to contract the worst in Asia outside of the Maldives, which is tourism dependent. And that actually caused, by 2021, it's only Thailand that didn't recover, that recovered worse than the Philippines in 2021. And we think that's so important, because if we have to be precise, the pandemic didn't cause the collapse in the economy, the collapse in livelihoods. It was the lockdowns. I think that leads naturally to the government has accountability for that, because other countries in Southeast Asia did not have as long lockdowns, did not collapse their economies as much, did not increase poverty in the same way we did. I think that points to the government being accountable for the overlong lockdowns. And I think they should be held accountable for the continued poverty even in 2022. And the demand for enough ayuda, additional ayuda, to actually spur not just the welfare of Filipinos, ordinary Filipinos, but to spur the economy, I think that gets much more traction. So we think it's quite important. It wasn't because of the pandemic. It was because of the lockdowns.
But take us back to, you did mention 2015 rates earlier. Take us back to 2015. Why was the poverty incidence rate high at 23.5%? What factors led to it? And as you said, it was actually remedied by infusion of the 7,000 peso 4-piece that you mentioned. Could we have adopted the same strategy in dealing with the this incidence rate, poverty incidence rate in 2021?
Well, ultimately, the most basic problem why we have such chronic poverty in the Philippines is because our agriculture sector and our manufacturing sector has been falling for the last four decades. That's been almost continuous since the 1970s. At the end of the Duterte administration, we saw the smallest agriculture in Philippine history, the smallest manufacturing sector since the 1950s. And these are the two key sectors for job generation. Services, unfortunately, they don't really create as many jobs as manufacturing and agriculture. And for structurally, we're not strengthening agriculture and manufacturing, that also means structurally we're not creating enough jobs, which results in such high poverty. And we also have to be, I think, quite discriminating about how we reduce poverty. It is, of course, important to have the cash transfers to alleviate immediately the poverty. But again, there's a limit to how much cash transfers can alleviate poverty, meaning the government budget. And I think if the government doesn't reassess really its, again, we believe misguided liberalization policies in agriculture and manufacturing, if it isn't correct, literally a four-decade-long decline in these two sectors, we will actually be able to resolve poverty, except for artificial methods like cash transfers. And to be honest, an overly low poverty threshold. And that 79 pesos per person per day, I think, is a warning sign for us. The 12,000 peso monthly for a family, that's a very low ambition poverty threshold. And we don't actually think the targets even for 2027 and 2028 will be achieved, considering job generation right now is still quite bad. Most job created is actually part-time work, self-employment, informal work. Secondly, the Philippines has never reduced poverty by what they're targeting in the next 6 years. And so I
90%.
Think it's, yeah, that's quite impossible. That comes about to a 2.5 percentage point increase every year. The Philippines has never reduced poverty by that much. Right now, we're facing the economic scarring. We're facing an economic slowdown. The economy contracted quarter on quarter in the second quarter. The global economy is actually quite volatile right now. So we think it's a bit better for the government to be more accepting about how difficult the problem is, how intractable it is, so that they can take, you know, bolder measures to fix that.
Mm-hmm. But what about the comment of the PSA and even economic managers saying that even if we have a higher poverty incidence rate 2021, they're not anticipating more people to be categorized as poor this year? How would you explain that?
I think it really is because the poverty line is actually too low. I think if they're saying that 80 pesos, for instance, lifts people above the poverty line, that's a bit unfair. I think that makes a lot of people invisibly poor. For us, for instance, a much better indicator of being in poverty is not having any savings. And the Banco Central's last second quarter survey amazingly found almost 19 million families, that's 7 out of 10 Filipino families, not having any savings. Basically, it's a hand-to-mouth existence. For us, I think that's a much more reasonable indicator of poverty and vulnerability. I think if the government had more ambition in terms of, let's not just fix the bottom 4 million families where the very, very poorest, they are, by, you know, of course, they're quite extremely poor. But if the government targets to look at the 18 to 19 million families without savings, that that sort of frames things in a much more, I think, ambitious way. And then they will be more, I think, pushed harder to do more, to spend more. And that's actually where we're so worried about the 2023 budget. By all accounts, the 5.3 trillion budget that will be submitted in 2023, unless it's changed, which doesn't look like it, that's going to be the smallest budget increase in 20 years. So exactly when when the economy is losing momentum, exactly when the number of Filipinos are increasing, you need expansionary fiscal policy. You need the government to spend, to put more money in people's pockets, to spur the economy. But seeing a budget that is the smallest budget increase in 20 years, basically the government is entering an austerity period just when we believe it should be spending more to spur welfare, to spur the economy.
Mm-hmm. You think what can be done to address this situation? Do you think providing more ayuda will actually help at this point, especially we're dealing with inflation?
Yeah. Well, right now, I think you're exactly correct. There are two legs to giving ayuda. Ayuda increases the purchasing power of families, but there also has to be support for micro, small, and medium enterprises for there to be a supply response and to mitigate inflation. And we would actually argue the need to improve household welfare actually coincides with the need to spur the local economy. And that's always been our sticking point with the infrastructure program. A lot of infrastructure spending, especially with the big ticket projects, that's spent abroad. It goes to, you know, importing materials, equipment, even contractors from Japan and China. And in terms of job generation, for instance, the Mindanao Railway project, only about 5% or less of the whole budget goes to its unskilled labor. So it doesn't actually get spent on creating employment. It doesn't get spent in the Philippines. And we'd argue, if you want to stimulate the economy to get more bang for your stimulus buck, it has to be money spent in the Philippines, circulating in the local economy as ayuda, as support to micro, small, and medium enterprises, as opposed to, you know, a distant promise of infrastructure will create opportunities down the line. People are suffering right now. Poverty is increasing right now. The money should be spent here in the Philippines right now.
But how sustainable would that be if you continue providing aid or ayuda? Obviously, the government was not able to see that as a sustainable venture because it was only able to give about two aids in the past pandemic, past few years. How could we do that given the limited resources?
Well, I have to go back to more, I think, the government has to consider much more radical options. Right now, for instance, just last week, we had the reports again of the wealthiest Filipinos. If the government thinks that the only resources to be generated are from consumption taxes, that is a fiscal straitjacket because people's incomes are collapsing. Right now, the fact that you have almost 19 million Filipinos without any savings, that also indicates if you increase consumption taxes, you'll be squeezing their welfare, and there's just so much you can increase in terms of revenues, whether it's plastic bags or the digital tax or what have you. For us, it really points to if there is a huge amount of resources untapped in terms of the wealth accumulated in a few Filipinos, that actually means that the government is tying its own hands. Of course, you would argue it's politically difficult, but again, it's an economic crisis. It is the government's job to sort of be more equitable, to balance costs and benefits for the economy. And we would argue, as many other governments around the world have argued, as even the IMF and the United Nations have argued, a wealth tax, even just at least a one-off wealth tax for a couple of years, or perpetual wealth tax on just the richest billionaires, that can generate resources for ayuda, for helping micro, small, and medium enterprises, for subsidizing agriculture, for boosting domestic manufacturing.
Interesting you talked about wealth tax, because how feasible is it for the government to actually collect that? How do you identify, for instance, the top 1,000 wealthiest individuals in the country and actually collect from them, given that we have incidents where, you know, we have collectibles of billions of taxes not yet paid up to now?
Well, identification is relatively easy, especially among the billionaires. I mean, the government can use as a starting point the way Forbes computes, because a lot of our billionaires, they have identified bank deposits, they have identified financial investments, they have identified stock ownership, and those are all on paper. That's basically the data is already there, and we don't even have to go into accessing their homes or their cars. That, you know, you don't even have to, if you don't want to, look at the real property. Just the financial investments can actually be identified in a quite straightforward manner. So I think in terms of identifying their wealth, that is quite easy to do. In terms of collecting it, that's a matter of, I'm sorry for the cliche, that's a matter of political will. If the government does feel that this is the moment, time of crisis, that those who have benefited from the economy can give back more to the economy, I think that's a question of the government pushing for that. And if the president did say that he has the largest electoral mandate in Philippine history, you begin quibble, is it the highest or the third? Mm-hmm. It's a large electoral mandate. And most of those who gave him that mandate are actually going to benefit from a wealth tax. And I think, again, it's a matter of pushing it. And we have to keep stressing, it is a fiscal straitjacket to be relying on consumption taxes in a poor economy like the Philippines. Even if they say we're going to be on the upper middle income economy, the fact that you had 7 out of 10 families living a hand-to-mouth existence were upper middle income because it's a concentration of wealth at the very richest. And we have to address that, I think, frontally to generate resources, to give back to the economy, and to spur growth and recovery.
Mm-hmm. Let me just go back to the PSA report, because the PSA was saying that it doesn't expect high inflation to push poverty higher this year. Do you agree with this assessment or with this statement? Explain to us the relationship between inflation and poverty incidence rates.
Well, the bottom line is, as inflation increases, it eats into the purchasing power of Filipinos. So, for instance, between 2018 and 2021, I don't think this was reported, adjusted for inflation, across the board, across all income deciles, the real income of families fell. I think it fell by over 6% for the poorest decile. It fell by almost 14% for the highest decile. So as prices increase, if people's incomes don't keep up, as happened in 2021, they are pushed into poverty. And it actually seems a bit odd for us, for the PSA to claim that inflation won't push more people into poverty right now. I heard the report about the self-created poverty results of the SWS. Actually, those seem to be much more reasonable standards, because by counting not just the self-declared poor, but by counting the borderline poor, it's the borderline poor who will be most affected by inflation in terms of being pushed into poverty. Because with an unchanged income, in a situation that you have 3 million officially unemployed right now, not even counting how 99% of the work it created since 2020 is in part-time work. I think that should say a lot about how the economy is struggling to recover. Not looking at the aggregate growth rates, looking at the job creation and the quality of jobs. So if inflation increases this year, if people's incomes aren't increasing, if they're still uncertain, they will be pushed into poverty, whether according to the PSA's very low standards of 79 pesos, or especially, I think, self-rated poverty standards like the SWS.
And talk about inflation. We're seeing higher prices of sugar recently because of supply issues. So there was a move to import sugar. It was canceled because supposedly it wasn't authorized. But we have the president now acknowledging the need to import sugar by October. But will importation of sugar work?
It's a short-term problem. Of course, we've had a long problem with sugar. The sugar industry has been a sunset industry with implications for production because, again, of the long-term trend of collapsing sugar prices. But I think as a short-term measure, we do have to import sugar because, you know, there's a limit to how much you can increase supply in the short term. But I think the president is on the right track if he thinks that controlling imports in the future and subsidizing to boost domestic sugar production, that is actually the medium to long-term solution for that. But again, I think it is an empirical matter. If there is a shortfall in sugar supply, which won't magically come from nowhere, I think imports are a reasonable measure in the short term to moderate inflation. But again, with a view over the medium and long term to increase domestic sugar supply to sort of preempt this dependence on imports, but also to create work and incomes in the rural sector.
Well, on that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Sunny Africa, Executive Director of Ibuan Foundation.
Thank you, Sir Mike. Morning.